generally when you play games which are more than 50 moves, the interpretation should be like it would have been a good closely contested match going into the end game, and one of the players came out through. But hold on, if that is your assumption so far, because this will definitely change it. It was done and dusted long back, and it was just a matter to finish, but my opponent hang in there eventually. But it was a complete knockout from the beginning. So let me take you through this game, and I hope it's an instructive one and you learn some serious chess tactics, you can call chess basics, you can call, and that helps you improve your game to the next level. Hey, chess lovers, welcome back to the chess yard. This is Dheirabhagya, and let me take you through this game. It starts off with d4, and my opponent responds with d5. I went with bishop to g5, the Levitsky attack. Open plays a knight to f6 here, and I respond with c3. Open plays a bishop now to f5, developing the bishop early. And generally, the best move is to take on this knight, because what happens is after the operand takes with any of the pawn structure for the operand will be weakened up. So that is what one way you can do. Or the other ways around is that you just keep maintaining this pin, because yes, the knight can move right now, but at least the pawn will not be able to, and we can just hold on to the diagonal, making sure that the queen cannot come out early. So I just went with e3 here. Open responds with a knight to d7. I'll just close the opening explorer. And again, I just continued my development. Knight to f3. Open goes with e6. I went with h4, trying to be aggressive on the king side. My opponent responds with h5, trying to block it the pawn simply. And then I went with queen onto b3, attacking the pawn on b7. I knew if I just develop my bishop onto b5, my opponent will play pawn forward, which blocks my bishop's way anyway, and I have to just move my bishop backwards again. So what's the whole point? Rather develop something else, which is going to be a threat as well to a pawn. And now opponent plays knight to b6, which is I just got my opponent's knight to deviate from its path completely. Opponent's knight was earlier connected with the other knight. The ideas could have been to break open the center eventually, but thanks to the move queen to b3, opponent's plans are completely changed straightforward. Now I go with a knight to d2, connecting both my knights. Opponent goes for bishop to e7, preparing to castle. So I thought, okay, let me just acquire the central square with my knight. Knight to e5, there's no threat to it because knight has just moved out from there. You have given me the access to a very central important square. So I acquire that with my knight. Opponent now goes back with knight to d7, so that opponent is willing to trade off the knights. My bishop is also hanging right now. Opponent can take the bishop. If the opponent takes, I can take back with the pawn. Opponent takes back with the queen, so I lose a pawn. That's another thing coming. So I thought, okay, let me do something else. I got my bishop backwards first. I don't want to give the extra pawn. Yes, the opponent can also still take, but then my idea was to take the knight, and opponent will probably take with the queen, and then I can take the bishop back as well. So that would be fine. But here, opponent goes with a rook to c8. Generally, when rooks comes to c8, the idea is to play c5 and break open the c file. And that can definitely happen next move. So I thought, okay, let me put my bishop to b5 first, which attacks the knight now. Now, if opponent has to save this, it is actually saved right now because knight is also controlling it, not a pressure. I'm just trying to build more pressure on this knight, not letting the opponent castle easily. Opponent can still castle and still be a bit tightly filed because of the crunch that I'm doing. Now, after castle, opponent might be thinking to exchange the knight as well, and I'm okay to take back with the bishop. The position is still solid. If you see the engine evaluation, it's equal position. My bishop comes on the knight diagonal towards the king, and I'll be happy doing that. So till now it's development moves, but I have made sure that my opponent is playing as per what I want the opponent to do, because you are white, you can dictate terms. And here my opponent plays c6, trying to kick my bishop backwards. And now I come back to e2. That was probably one of the best options I had. So I came back there. And here opponent plays bishop to f6, feeling the heat of this knight. The opponent is so much willing to just take this knight with the bishop. Could have taken with the knight straight away though. But then I take with the bishop and I have the diagonal. So opponent then want me to give the diagonal as well. Here I connect both the knights, knight to f3. Again, putting more pressure on the center. I am fighting for this big center and I don't want to displace my knight from here. Now opponent plays c5, trying to go for the earlier plan, open up the c file. I take, he takes, and then c file belongs to the opponent because the rook is standing there. But here comes the next move, knight takes knight. And if you see, after playing c5, my opponent's position crumbled already to 1.8. I take here, opponent takes back with the queen, which is a blunder again because here comes bishop. If the opponent would have taken with the knight, let's go back and see. If the opponent takes with the knight, still I have queen takes b7. I get the extra pawn as well. This knight is probably weakened up as well. Pawn, so I can grab another pawn. This one is also hanging already. If opponent takes, I can take back with the knight, getting to attack the bishop. The dark square bishop is lined up very nice. So you cannot actually save the pawn as well, even if I don't take it on this turn. So it is like completely dominating position so early in the game. But here after I take the pawn, opponent can take back and things like can go in this way. Let's go back in the game where opponent played, opponent took with the queen instead. And then I got the bishop onto b5, attacking the queen. And it's a pin which can only be removed with a rook comes to c6. Now again, I can take the rook straight away, but I thought, okay, hold on, let me just take the c pawn first. It's free of cost, it attacks the knight, pushes the knight backwards. Why not take a free pawn? So I took it, opponent goes back with the knight. It's only move number 16, I am 3.8 up already in the game. Now I offer opponent the bishop exchange. Why so? Because once the opponent does take, my knight will be in the central square. Again, it's a fork on the queen and the rook, and I'm just trying to pressurize. See, I can simply take here, I can take the rook with the bishop, but I just hold it on because this is not going anywhere. What I can do is improve the position of other pieces and get into attack. Here, opponent, of course, didn't take because opponent knew what's coming. And I still thought, okay, let me take the bishop. Because now the opponent's pawn structure also is spoiled towards the king side. So now castling looks very tough. It is actually a bad idea if you castle now. And so here I went with a knight goes to d4, attacking the rook again now. So two pieces now attacking it. And it is well defended though, but not a problem. But here opponent goes back with the bishop to g6. And now I take the rook, opponent takes back with the knight. And I trade off the knight as well. I don't want the knights to be around and giving me troubles later on. Opponent takes back with the queen. And if you see now, I am exchange up, I am pawn up. Opponent cannot castle. I can castle either side. It's a huge advantage. I am 4.2 ahead as per Stockfish right now. Still running though. But it's a decent advantage. So I thought, okay, let me begin with saving the pawn. Not letting the opponent come back in the game by even getting an extra pawn. So I defended the pawn with queen coming to b4. Opponent castles here. And I said it's a bad idea because this bishop can be easily pinned later on. And I thought, okay, let me try and do it straight away. I went with rook to h3. It's an inaccuracy as per the computer, but your plans and computer's plan don't match every time. Opponent gets the queen onto c8, trying to grab the extra pawn. And here I place my rook to g3 first, pinning this bishop. Opponent takes the pawn. And now I took some time here in this move. If you see the time comparison on the clock, opponent was 1 minute 53 seconds. I was 1 minute 42 seconds. I took my time here. I want to trade off the queens right now or not. It's an important decision always. And then I thought, okay, my opponent is exchanged down. Yes, which is bishop for a rook. Rook is a stronger piece. But bishop is no joke in the end game. Bishop can cause you a lot of troubles. It can always control the queening squares. Can always defend the pawns on light squares. And my opponent's most pawns were on the light squares. So I thought, okay, let me not trade off my queen right now, but at least grab a pawn for that. So I took on b7 here with the queen. Opponent now places a rook to c7, attacking the queen. And now again, I have to think where my queen goes next. So I got it on b3 this time because I want to get back into the defenses as well if required. I want to be around my pieces. I have done the damage already. Opponent is not going to win it easy from here if I control all my pieces in a proper way. Opponent goes with a rook to c6, which the idea come clearly tells. It's going to come to b6 next, attack my queen and the pawn, and I cannot defend it from c2 because, yes, the bishop is pinned for now. I can do it temporarily, but it's not a good idea because after the king moves, I have to again move the queen from there. So I've thought, okay, let me now give the queen for trade because I have got the extra pawn and now is the time to exchange. We did exchange there. And now again, opponent tries to attack the pawn on b2. Here, I played a rook to b1, defending the pawn, which is again an inaccuracy as per the computer. But finally, opponent removes the pin from the bishop. I play a3. And now, king comes to e7. Here in this position, I was thinking, what should I do? And maybe I was slipping down on time as well. Yes, 43 seconds on the clock. And I made a bad move, which was king to d1. Which got my opponent almost back in the game. It is a drawish kind of a situation. Still advantageous to white. 0.7 is decent enough in the end game. Plus I had the rook, so I thought it's okay. Opponent takes on the pawn. I have to save the rook. So rook comes to c1. And now king moves to d7. The only thing which is problematic for the opponent is I have control of the c file. That is an important thing. I have cut off the king coming from here, coming to the other side of the board. And these three pawns, one of them should promote eventually. It's 3-1. Okay, you can call it 2-1 because these are double pawns as well. So you can call it 2-1, but that's a decent advantage. I tried to first save my pawn by moving to b3. Opponent plays a bishop to e4, attacking the pawn and trying to get the extra pawn. And I thought, oh, this is completely okay. That's what I want. My pawns are stronger here. If the trade happens, I'm likely to win it easily from there. I went with king to e1, attacking the king, attacking the rook, so that rook moves. Rook takes the pawn, which is completely winning for me. The best move for the opponent was to go to rook with the b2 and then maybe try to grab the pawn there. But then again, I can simply do the rook lifts. I can also get involved in the position. There's nothing much challenging. As I said, I can do the rook lift and defend the pawn. Opponent can still fight for it till the situation completely crumbles, but it was still in my favor. Let's go back in the game where opponent decided to take on the rook. I take back. Opponent takes back with the bishop. And here comes king to f2, attacking the bishop. Bishop goes back to e4, and now I place a rook to c5, cutting off the rook and the pawn, the king and the pawn as well. About to take it next, maybe. So opponent plays bishop to d3, and now once I go to rook to a5, opponent can play pawn forward. I came back. Now, if you think that this was played very like it's a bad move because I'm repeating, doesn't make sense. I was low on time, 21 seconds against 43. So my opponent was playing very fast. And I have to match up sometimes the speed as well, just to throw him off the book. So opponent now plays king to d6. And now I play king to f3. My rook is already defended, nothing to worry. Opponent plays e5. I go back with the king, fast moves there. And I went with king to g3 next. Opponent plays f6. I again move the king, and now e4 by opponent. I went with a4, thinking that I can just trade off some pawns there. Opponent plays king to e5, allowing me to play b5. Opponent takes, I take back. Now king moves backwards to d6. Now rook comes to c6 with a check. Opponent tried to just stay near the pawns by placing king on d7. I take on the rook. Opponent takes my pawn. I take another pawn. And then I take another pawn. And then I just put it on g5. Making sure that the G file is mine now, and then I can simply push for the pawn. Getting the rook to G3 my last time because it's on a dark square, nothing will happen. and it will be defended with the king. Here also was a dark square, but once I move the pawn up and will irritate me by moving the king here, and then I have to move my rook back. So I was just trying to pre-move, thinking what my opponent might be doing. Opponent goes with king f6, but that's a waste of a move because my pawn is going to move and you cannot stop it. Rather, the opponent could have just placed bishop behind and then probably worked it out, though it was also of no use. I'm 8.2 ahead already. I just then went on with my pawn. Doesn't matter what my opponent is doing. Keep doing it. Here comes the check. Here comes another. I just went with queen to d4 first, making sure that I'm not allowing opponent to queen. Here comes rook to g6. Opponent moves to f5. And I didn't expect the opponent to actually play king to f5. So I just went with a check again with the rook. And in this position, actually, my opponent ran out of time. It was 3 seconds remaining with me still. And it was, again, mate in three from there as well. So completely winning position, as I said. Most of the game, I wasn't bothered at all. If you see the graph, most advantage my opponent got was 0.6 in the favor, which is like very little. And I was dominating this almost throughout. I hope you enjoyed the video. I hope it was instructive enough. And you do like it, please do subscribe to the channel as well if you have seen this far. And I assure you that you will get some good quality content every single day, no matter what. Thanks for watching. Take care. Bye-bye.